It is now time to nominate candidates for our constitutional positions. President, Secretary Treasurer, and 55 vice presidents to four-year terms that will begin upon their election. This process is outlined in Rules 18 to 44 of the Convention's Standing Rules. First, Mike Sacco, the Senior Vice President of the Federation, who has notified the Chair that he does not intend to make or second a nomination for executive office, will conduct the nominations for the office of President. Mike Sacco will next conduct the nominations for the office of Secretary Treasurer in that order. Nominations for each office will close before nominations begin for the next office. Any delegate may make a nomination for any of these offices and may speak for 5 minutes in support of the nomination. There must be two seconders in order to make a nomination. Each seconder may speak for 3 minutes. If there's only one nominee for an executive officer position, the nominee will be declared elected. After the executive officers are nominated, I, as chair of the convention, will conduct nominations for the 55 vice president positions. And under the rules, there are two methods for nominating a vice president. First, a signed nomination and two signed seconds for either a single nominee or a slate of nominees, up to the total of 55 vice president positions, may be submitted before the nominations for executive officers begin. Or nominations may be made and then seconded twice from the floor. The Secretary-Treasurer will first read the submitted written nominations, and then the floor will be opened for further nominations. No speeches will be made in support of any nomination for vice president, whether previously submitted in writing or made from the floor. Again, a delegate may nominate any number of individuals up to 55 for the office of vice president, which must have 2 seconds. A nominator may also designate his or her nominee as part of a new slate. Before any election ballot is printed, a nominee who part of a slate will have to notify the election officers that, in fact, he or she accepts the nomination and is running on the slate. And each individual nominee must notify the election officers that he or she accepts the nomination. If there are no more than 55 nominees for vice president, the nominees will be declared elected. If there are more than one nominee for any of the executive offices or more than 55 nominees for vice president, the convention will recess and an election will be conducted immediately. As Sister Gwen Mills announced earlier, the election will be conducted by former Vice President Paul Rinaldi, whom I have appointed as elections officer. If an election is required, Brother Rinaldi will explain the procedures for the election before the convention recesses today. So here we go. I now turn the chair over to Brother Mike Sacco to conduct the nominations for the executive offices. Mike.
Somewhere beyond the sea, somewhere waiting for me, my lover stands on golden sands and watches the ships that go sailing.
It's election time. Is everybody ready? Brothers and sisters, nominations are now open for the office of the President of the AFL-CIO. The chair recognizes Lonnie Stevenson, President of the Brotherhood of Electric Workers. Lonnie?
Hello, am I on yet? Mic on? There we go.
Go get him.
Thank you. Thank you, brother. My name is Lonnie Stevenson. I'm the president of the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers. and I have surrounding the entire IBEW delegation with me here as I make this nomination. Today, we're going to make history by nominating the first woman president of the AFL-CIO. We're also going to make history by nominating the first IBEW member to be an AFL-CIO president. And we could not be prouder of our sister, Liz Shuler. They say if you want the job done right, what we always say, get it done right, you call an IBEW electrician. And throughout her career, Liz has embodied that common sense. Do it the right way, not the easy way. Approach that every IBEW member brings to every job. It's a value that she learned early in life from her father, Lance Shuler, who's with us here today and standing next to me. Brother Shuler is a retired member of Liz's home local, IBEW Local 125 in Portland, Oregon, where he was a longtime power lineman for Portland General Electric. And we share his eminence pride in the heights that his daughter and our sister has reached in her pursuit of a better life for American working families. Liz has embodied that IBEW can-do spirit that Lance taught her. For the nearly 20 years that I've known her, she's earned the respect and admiration of thousands of others along the way, establishing a reputation as known as a consensus builder, more interested in the common goal than who gets the credit. We have something in the IBEW that we call a code of excellence, which commits every member to total professionalism, dedication, and pride in a job well done. And from Liz's first days as an IBEW activist at PGE, all the way to the top of the AFL-CIO, she's never wavered in giving the labor movement her all each and every day. Ask anyone. Beth, thank you. Ask anyone who's had the honor to work with Liz Shuler, and they'll tell you she gets the job done right the first time. When we lost our dear brother, Rich Trumka, Liz stepped up under very difficult conditions and ensured that the work of the AFL-CIO and the mission of the AFL-CIO would continue. And she followed his example, understanding that effective leadership in this organization means including and involving the leaders of each union. But Liz isn't just a hard worker. Like every great leader, she inspires others to lead as well. She's encouraged others to get involved, take chances, and give everything they've got to this great movement of ours, especially those who never thought that they could be leaders. So many of the labor leaders amongst us were an activist where they could today because of Liz's example and her leadership. One of those is our own International Vice President, Gina Cooper, who couldn't be with us today at our convention, but our convention back in May, Gina Cooper was elected the first woman international officer in the IBEW system. That was a groundbreaking moment for the IBEW, but it wouldn't have happened without everything that Liz did for our union as a later movement. Her entire life in labor has been devoted to opening doors and creating opportunities for every working person. Every day our movement gets growing stronger, bigger, and more diverse, and we owe so much of that to Liz's leadership and vision. The IBEW broke a big glass ceiling at our convention, and we're here to break another enormous one here today when we elect Liz Shuler as AFL-CIO president. Fellow delegates, I hereby nominate our sister, my friend, the voice of the American labor and working families, Elizabeth Shuler, for president of the AFL-CIO. Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, Elizabeth Shula has been nominated for the office of president. Is there a second? The chair recognizes Randy Weinberger, president of the American Federation of Teachers. Where are you, Randy?
The other side! My name is Randy Weingarten, if you didn't know that yet. I rise to second the nomination of Liz Shuler as president of the AFL-CIO. And you see behind me are many generations of AFT leaders who are proud to represent 1.7 million educators, healthcare professionals, and public employees in this land. Thank you, all of you. I was proud to second the nomination of Liz as president of the AFL-CIO in August of 2021, and the board elected her unanimously. And I think since then, the convention delegates, frankly, the entire AFL-CIO, understood why she was elected as president, and I urge us to elect her as president unanimously by this convention. As I said in August, Liz is a friend and a colleague, but she's much more than that. She's an able leader who is smart and strategic. She's an ally and an activist, and she is caring and compassionate. She's as tenacious and persistent a champion of the aspiration of workers as you will ever see. Liz believes that the road to worker aspirations run through the labor movement and the power building we do as a movement. This means politics, of course, but it also means a real focus on organizing, on community, and on solidarity. Liz is solidarity in action. Look at what she's done since August. Whether it's meeting with young activists on the grounds of Starbucks or a picket line at Kellogg's and Nabisco, Liz is walking with workers. Whether it's uplifting and building on the apprenticeship opportunities in the building trades, Liz is there to promote diversity. In DC, we haven't lost a beat. Whether it's helping promote the infrastructure bill or working with the Biden administration to implement the most pro-labor agenda in generations, Liz is leading that. And whether it's prodding or cajoling the Biden administration on student debt relief or in safety and health, Liz is leading that as well. Whether it's envisioning how to do things better within our movement, as you will see in our resolution on politics and on state and local bodies, Liz does that as well. Or whether it's organizing, whether it's embracing the National Women's Soccer League Players Association as they join the AFL-CIO, or embarking, as you heard this morning, on the most ambitious organizing agenda in generations. She is a bridge builder, a consensus seeker, a unifier. Liz knows there is power in listening as well as power in doing. That is what unions do, and that is what Liz does. We help make things better for people. I have about 30 more seconds left. And while solving the problems of the present, Liz is more than ready to carry us into the future. She's challenged us to organize, she's challenged us to be bold, and she's challenged us to take risks like never before. And let me end with a story about Liz. On Friday, I was at a ribbon cutting of Renaissance Village in McDowell County, West Virginia, the first multi-story building in Welsh in 50 years. McDowell was proud coal country, and it's been abandoned in so many ways. And we have been there trying to lift it up and trying to figure out how to build this housing. It was hard, but we did it because of Liz. And by the way, we did it union. Liz figured out how to bring HIT into, of course we did it union. Liz figured out how to bring HIT into the project to house teachers. She figured out how we raised the money, and now 90% of the 20 apartments are rented. There are multiple businesses in there. There's a new cafe in there, and that is what it means to be a community organizer and an activist and a union activist, and that is who Liz Shuler is, and I am proud with the AFT family to second her nomination for president.
Whoa! Elizabeth Shuler's nomination for the office of president has been seconded. Is there another second? The chair recognizes Leonard Aguilar, Secretary Treasurer of the Texas AFL-CIO. Where are you? Leonard, there he is.
Here I am. Hello, brothers and sisters. My name is Leonard Aguilar, and I'm the Secretary Treasurer of the Texas AFL-CIO, and I want to say it's an honor to be here. First, I have to thank my family. I have to thank my wife and my children for allowing me this opportunity to be here with you. Without them, this wouldn't happen. I stand before you today to second the nomination for Liz Shuler as the first woman president of our federation. My daughters, Sada and Sophia, standing right behind me here, are in the hall tonight, and I couldn't be more proud. They get to see me stand up for a woman who's going to stand up for them as young Latino women who aspire to do big things. Liz met my daughters many years ago when they were, you know, little girls, younger girls. You came off a stage from a speech, took the time to shake their hands, took time to get to know them for a few minutes, and it stuck with them. And ever since then, whenever we do see stuff come up on social media or see how things are going, keeping track of the AFL, they say, look, there's Miss Liz, when I show them the pictures of what's going on. So now for Miss Liz, I'm proud to say that we're going to be able to say, look, there's President Liz. My family is my foundation. My daughters are my future. And their generation is the future of our movement. From day one of her time at the AFL-CIO, Liz invested in young workers to make our movement inclusive for young people. She has been relentless in her effort to create paths into labor for young workers through organizing strategies, earn and learn opportunities like the plumbing apprenticeship that I went through, mobilizing young working programs in our unions and our federations. That's how I first met Liz, was trying to organize young workers, and I was able to help work and create the first chapter of the Texas Young Active Labor Leaders, Y'all. Texas Y'all started back then, still going strong now. At that time, I was still on the tools, learning about a broader labor movement through my UA local and CLC in San Antonio, Texas. And many years later into my career, she still calls me a young worker. I appreciate it, but we know that's not the truth anymore. Liz was ahead of us, ahead of all of us. Young workers approve of unions more than any other group. Now more than ever, they know the economy isn't working for them and they're doing something about it. They're organizing, and they're not just organizing, they're winning. We need their energy, we need their leadership, and we can learn from their organizing skills. I'm here today, backed up by my Texas Labor family. It's okay, you can go ahead and clap for them. And we're here in force because Liz knows our collective power comes from the ground up. Our movement begins and ends in the communities around the country. And all of our collective power comes through our state and local federations all around America. From the great state of Texas, to Alaska, from Arizona to New Jersey, from Puerto Rico, or to Liz's home state of Oregon. And importantly, Liz understands the importance of investing in the South. The South is important to the labor movement, and that if the labor movement is going to change in this country, it has to include growing and changing places like our home state of Texas. So here we go. The moment in history demands a new kind of leadership, someone who isn't afraid to do things differently, a leader who sees opportunity and possibility, not peril, an organizer who is willing to set a bold vision for growing our movement, and most important, a leadership team that represents the diversity and working class of our membership. I know she will wake up every day and work as hard as she can to make sure my children's future, your children's future, our children's future include the promise of a union card, and that every community has that same chance to organize and rise. Now, brothers and sisters, are you ready? Are you ready? Then join me in supporting Liz Shuler for president. This is our moment.
The nomination of a legislature for the office of the president has been properly made and seconded twice. Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Seeing no delegates who wish to be recognized, the chair declares the nomination for the office of president closed. In accordance with the rule of the convention, Elizabeth Shuler is declared president of the AFL-CIO. Congratulations. She's gonna make a great one, believe me. She's gonna make a great one. Okay, nominations are now open for the office of Secretary Treasurer of the AFL-CIO, and the chair recognizes Tom Conway, President of the United Steelworkers. Tom?
Chairman.
There he is.
My name is Tom Conway. I'm the president of the Steelworkers Union. I'm surrounded by our family today, and we're all so proud to make this nomination of our brother, Fred Redmond. This is an amazing story of a man who can trace his ancestry back on both sides, his paternal and maternal families, to slavery, and who can move up through the years, and whose family moves to Chicago, and his dad works jobs sweeping floors and pumping gas and building a future for his family, and his mom travels on 3 buses a day to clean homes for other people. And during that time, they raised their family together. And as a young teenager, Fred and his siblings and his cousins traveled back to Mississippi to work on the sharecropper farm that his grandparents worked on other people's property, and literally pick the field and pick cotton so their grandparents can survive and thrive. And Fred learns work and the value of work and the value of family and the value of labor as he's a young person. And as time goes by, Fred's uncle and his dad land a job at Reynolds Aluminum, and they become active in their union. Fred remembers getting dental coverage, getting health care, getting the things that come with the union contract. And soon he follows his uncle and his dad into the ranks of the union and begins to move up and runs for office, mostly because he complains to his dad and his uncle about he doesn't like things, and they tell him, well, you better show up at meetings and start fixing it. And we watch Fred move through that career from the presidency at local union to the staff, through our structure of our districts, eventually to the vice presidency of the steelworker union, and along the way develop mentorships and bring other people with him in a way that few people in our union have ever done. And Fred is one of those persons that has that ability to reach out to everyone, to see their value, to include them in it, to mentor them, to train them in the value of having to do the work in order to move forward and take your place in this union. Together, he and I were staff reps in the days when the early days of private equity funds would show up. No one knew what they were. We would look at each other and say, the hell are we going to do with this? But working with Fred has just been such an honor and a privilege for me. And frankly, I've never seen someone as courageous as Fred has been, who's faced tough issues. When Richie Trumka asked Fred to form the race commission and move into a conversation that was going to be so difficult, and he stepped in there and did that with such grace and such consensus building and such ability to build bridges. And I've seen him do that so many times since then. And he's bargained contracts across our sectors, across our union, and in healthcare, and in shipbuilding, and in public sector, and in manufacturing, and in metals, and every assignment that came his way. Fred was able to go in and find that deal and get that contract and move people forward. And so it's really just an amazing story, and our union could not be prouder of Fred. There is no one better prepared to form this partnership with Liz, to move forward, to move our federation forward, to build the consensus, to bring together the people that we know need to be together for this country and our labor movement to survive. So on behalf of all these steelworkers here, we're so proud to nominate our brother, Fred Redmond, to the position of Secretary and Treasurer of the AFL-CIO.
Fred Redmond has been nominated for the office of Secretary Treasurer. Is there a second? The chair recognizes Steve McGarvey, President of North American Building Trades Council.
Mr. Chairman.
Where are you?
Over here, Mr. Chairman.
Here he is.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. I'm Sean McGarvey, and I'm the President of North America's Building Trades Unions. And I'm honored to rise today to support Fred Redmond. I know Fred's commitment firsthand to workers and the labor movement. He is and has always been an active leader, fully engaged and intentional. When he had the opportunity to work for his international, United Steelworkers recognized his exceptional leadership and genuine devotion to mission. He was all in, dedicating decades of service to workers in various staff and leadership roles, assisting local unions, developing and conducting training programs, and bargaining contracts from coast to coast. As a community activist and a black leader during a pivotal and vastly prejudiced time in American history, Fred fought tirelessly and continues fighting today for racial justice in the workplace and throughout our communities. Fred recognized the potential of uplifting people through training and has mentored and partnered and encouraged all of us in labor throughout his career. He's broken down barriers so we all can seek a better opportunity. He has seen firsthand the efforts of my unions, the building trades, over the last decades to attract and retain the next generation of craft professionals with a focus on those that have been underserved, particularly communities of color, women, veterans, and the formerly incarcerated. He knows this is real work. He knows these pathway programs change lives. He knows that in order to build America up, we must forge meaningful partnerships and create ladders of opportunity for all those in search of one. With his continued leadership, support, and counsel, we can and will take these programs to the next level and expand like never before. All of us who know Fred know he is no show pony. Fred Redmond is focused not on the limelight, but on the blocking and tackling that actually makes a real difference for individuals, communities, and in our entire country. It is an honor to know him It's an honor to work with him, and it's an honor to be led by him. On behalf of 14 affiliated international unions of North America's building trades and our 3 million members throughout North America, I proudly second the nomination of Frederick D. Redmond for Secretary-Treasurer of the AFL-CIO.
Fred Redmond's nomination to the office of Secretary-Treasurer has been seconded. Is there another second? The chair recognizes Lee Powell, Secretary-Treasurer of the American Postal Workers Union.
I'm over here.
Where are you, Lee? There you are.
Giving honor to God, special recognition and all due respect to everyone assembled here. Good evening. My name is Elizabeth Liz Powell, and I am the Secretary-Treasurer of the American Postal Workers Union. And I proudly stand here to second the nomination of my friend and my brother, Fred Redmond, for Secretary-Treasurer of the AFL-CIO. Fred is a commended youth trade unionist who has dedicated his life to the betterment of working people all across this country. He has fought and continues to fight for racial and economic justice in the workplace and throughout our communities in the United States. His unwavering support for working people, his commitment to the values of the labor movement, his desire to grow the labor movement, and his heart for lifting people up are just some of the reasons that I know he is the right person to help lead the AFL-CIO as his Secretary-Treasurer. I have worked with Brother Fred on different issues and personally know his commitment and dedication. I am proud and honored to help build the movement, to meet the moment, to lend my voice in support of the American Postal Workers Union, and so move his nomination.
The nomination of Fred Redmond for the office of Secretary-Treasurer has been properly made and seconded twice. Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Are there any further nominations? Seeing no delegates who wish to be recognized, the chair declares the nominations for the office of Secretary-Treasurer closed. In accordance with the rules of this convention, Fred Redmond is elected Executive Secretary, elected Secretary-Treasurer of the AFL-CIO. Congratulations, Fred. Come here, both of you. Ladies and gentlemen, the winning team.
Thank you so much, and thank you, Mike Sacco. Wow, that was amazing. And Mike has been has conducted our elections for as many conventions as I can remember. So thank you again, Mike, for doing it yet another convention. So now we're going to continue with the nominations for vice presidents of the AFL-CIO. So in compliance with the convention standing rules, I have submitted nominations of a slate of 55 members of the AFL-CIO for 55 positions of vice president. Each has been nominated by AFSCME President Lee Saunders and seconded by TWU President John Samuelson and Nashville and Middle Tennessee CLC President Vonda McDaniel. Secretary Treasurer Redmond will now read the list of nominees.
In the top 55 nominees for Vice President in alphabetical order. Stuart Applebaum, Retail Wholesale and Department Store Union, UFCW. Matthew Biggs, International Federation of Professional and Technical Engineers. Roxanne Brown, United Steelworkers. Megan Burke, National Women's Soccer Players Association. Bernie Burnham, Minnesota AFL-CIO. James Callahan, Operating Engineers. Frank Christensen, Elevator Operators. Gina Cooper, Electrical Workers. Gabrielle Carteris, SAG-AFTRA. Bonnie Castillo, National Nurses United. Tom Conway, United Steelworkers. John Costa, Amalgamated Transit Union. Ray Curry, United Auto Workers. Evelyn DeJesus, American Federations of Teachers. Joe DePete, Airline Pilots Association. Eric Dean, Iron Workers. Mark Demenstein, American Postal Workers Union. Tim Driscoll, Bricklayers. Cheryl Eliano, AFGE. Sydney Estrada, United Auto Workers. Warren Fairley, Boilermakers. Everett Kelly, AFGE. Edward Kelly, Firefighters. Richard Lanigan, Office and Professional Employees. Matt Lowe, Theatrical Stage Employees. Ernie Logan, School Administrators. Bob Martinez, Machinist. Arthur Maratera, TCUIAM. Elissa McBride, AFSCME. Bonda McDaniel, Nashville and Middle Tennessee Central Labor Council. Sean McGarvey, North American Building Trades Unions. Mark McManus, United Association of Plumbers and Pipefitters. Gwen Mills, United Here. Sarah Nelson, Association of Flight Attendants, CWA. Terry O'Sullivan, Laborers. Mark Perrone, United Food and Commercial Workers. Roland Rexa, Marine Engineers Beneficial Association. Cecil Roberts, United Mine Workers. Fred Rolando, National Association of Letter Carriers. Mike Sacco, CFARS. John Samuelson, Transportation Workers Union. Rich Santa, National Air Traffic Controllers Association. Lee Saunders, AFSCME. Joe Sellers, SMART. Anthony Shelton, Bakery, Confectionery, Tobacco Workers and Grain Millers. Chris Shelton, Communication Workers of America. Jim Slevin, Utility Workers. DeMaurice Smith, NFL Players Association. Lonnie Stevenson, Electrical Workers. D. Taylor, Unite Here. Ben Baldapena, California School Employees Association. Baltimore Velasquez, Farm Laborers Organizing Committee. Randy Weingarten, American Federation of Teachers. Jim Williams Jr., Painters and Allied Trades. Charlie Wakonik, New Jersey AFL-CIO. President Shuler, back to you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Fred. The slate of 55 members whose names have just been read has been properly nominated and seconded twice. Are there any other nominations? Are there any other nominations? Are there any other nominations? Seeing no delegate who seeks to be recognized, the chair declares that nominations for the office of vice president are closed. In accordance with the rules of this convention, I declare that the 55 nominees just read are elected as vice presidents of the AFL-CIO. Congratulations to all. Congratulations to our vice presidents and our incredible newly elected secretary treasurer. And I am so excited to bring up my partner, Fred Redmond. And I could not have asked for a better partner and friend to lead the Federation into this next chapter, us together. Fred not only has the track record, the experience, and the commitment to our labor movement, as you heard with those fabulous nomination speeches and seconds, but he is someone who has earned the trust and confidence of all working people across the country and truly around the world with his global work. He is a genuine thought partner. He brings humor, compassion, tenacity that I truly admire. And he's someone who always has a story or a lesson to share that makes this journey a little easier. Even in the tough times, he always sees the optimistic way forward. And I think back to the night before Rich Trumka passed away last August. Fred and I were together at the LACLA convention in Las Vegas. We met to talk about forming our ticket to run together as a team here at that convention the night before Rich passed. That was the future we were planning for. And when I learned the next morning the news of Rich's passing, I reached for Fred immediately, knowing our plans would have to change much sooner than we thought. And we charted a path forward. We also looked to our own pasts to see what we wanted to build on. And there's no greater example than the Young Worker Program. Fred started the Next Gen program at the Steelworkers as we were working on Next Up at the AFL-CIO. And to a person, those Steelworker Next Gen members looked to Fred for mentorship and support. And they talk about it to this day. And I see those Next Gen leaders throughout our convention. In fact, EJ was hosting our interfaith breakfast this morning. He was a Next Gener. So we're going to build on that. And I speak for the entire Federation when I say we are so grateful to Fred for taking on this leadership challenge, and I look forward to blazing new paths together and building on the incredible work and history that you have created over your career, Fred. So come on up, our Secretary Treasurer, Fred Redmond. The podium is yours.
So thank you. Thank you very much. And I want to thank you, Liz. And I want you to know how proud I am of you. And how proud I am to serve alongside you. And how excited I am to continue our work together. You know, when we were down in Alabama earlier this year, Liz and myself, in support of the Warrior Med Strikers, Liz was huddled in a corner with a striker and his wife, giving them some words of encouragement. And when Liz walked away, I overheard that mine worker. I overheard him, Liz, talking about you. He said, that woman is union from the hair on the top of her head to the dirt on the bottom of her shoes. And Liz, he was absolutely right. You are union through and through. You are tough, smart, and strong, and you are, without a doubt, the right person to lead this labor movement. And I just want to say thanks to all of you for believing in me. It has been one of the greatest privileges of my career to serve in this capacity. Your support is truly humbling. You know, earlier this week, my wife Ann and I, we celebrated our 47th wedding anniversary. And, yeah. See, we've been on this journey together. And Ann is here, and I just want to say to you that I'm incredibly lucky and incredibly blessed to have you in my life as the matriarch of our family. And I love you more and more every day. And I'm happy to have my family here sharing this moment with me. My daughter Morgan, a young lady who just fascinates me every day. You know, she was a great daughter. She didn't get in too much trouble. But she grew up to be a very, very exceptional mother and a wife. And my son-in-law, Mike Morris, is here, along with my grandson, Jordan, and his partner, Tabby. And my other grandson, Marcus, is here too, with his fiance, Sania Warren, my granddaughter, Anasia, and a special friend of our family's, Diana Warren. And I also want to give a shout out to Becca Smith, a good friend of ours. She make a mean chocolate cake too, so I want to make sure I recognize her. But look, I love you all more than you could possibly know. And it's special for me to have my family here at this moment. And I want to give a special thanks to my union, the United Steelworkers, to my friend for over 25 years, my president, Tom Conway, for putting my name forward, and for your unyielding trust in me. The Steelworkers Union has nurtured me, and they have allowed me the opportunity to be a leader in our great union. And I will always be indebted to you, Tom, and the former president, Leo Girard, who brought me on board. I can't thank you enough. And to all of my brothers and sisters and siblings at the Steelworkers Union. And I want to thank my friend, Sean McGarvey, president of North America's Building Trades Unions, for seconding my nomination. I am so honored to have his support and the support of the building trades. NAPTU is literally changing lives. They have the most comprehensive training program in the entire world. Their apprenticeship programs are giving so many people the opportunity to build a solid career. They're changing lives, and their commitment to underserved communities is something everybody in this labor movement should be extremely proud of. Sean, thanks again, my brother. I appreciate you. And to my sister Liz Powell, who I've known for many years, thank you for your second and your continued commitment to racial and social justice. You know, one of the untold stories in our labor movement is the work of the American postal workers and all the postal workers' unions during the election of 2020. I don't think that work is recognized enough in our movement. Their commitment to make sure that every ballot was delivered and counted while facing intense resistance from none other than the Postmaster General himself. That took courage, and it is a true example of the labor movement's commitment to democracy. I want to thank all the postal workers' unions, all of them, for the great work that you did. And I like, that's right, just give it up for them, you know. And I want to thank my staff at the AFL-CIO, in particular, Marcus Medley, Crystal King and Sherry Cannon, our director of accounting, and her entire team. And I would also like to thank our team in the Secretary Treasurer's office, Taima Perry, Mac Harrell, Jamie Garcia, and especially J.P. Smith. J.P. came over with me from the Steelworkers Union, and I am very proud to have witnessed his development in the labor movement. He is not only the best executive assistant and chief of staff that I could have, but he is also one of my dearest friends. So I want to say thank you, JP, for everything you do every day. Look, this is an historic election, an historic moment for the labor movement. You know, I know the spotlight is on Liz and I right now, but I need to use this moment to recognize a few of the people upon whose shoulders I stand. People who struggle to gain respect in this movement. They stuck with it because they realized that the labor movement was the strongest vehicle to improve people's lives and build a black middle class. I'm talking about people like A. Philip Randolph, Bayard Rustin, Bill Lucy, Linda Shavaz Thompson, Arlene Holt Baker. You see, they're labor legends for good reason, because they were true pioneers in their commitment to bring the labor movement and the civil rights movements together. And in their unwavering advocacy for black workers in the workplace and in our unions, I learned from them that we have to get our own house in order first. You know, in my union, this moment would not be possible for me without Leon Lynch, the first African-American vice president of the steelworkers. And people like Oliver Montgomery. Oliver spoke truth to power and challenged my union on issues of racial justice during a time when these issues were not being heard. Ola Kennedy, she was the first African-American woman to hold an elected office at one of our large basic steel locals. You see, these are people who broke barriers in my union and opened so many doors for me as a trade unionist and for so many others. But we all know that once you get through those doors, you need friends, you need mentors. And in my union, I've been blessed. I've been so lucky to find those friends and mentors and people like Leo Girard, Tom Conway, George Becker, Jim English, Rich Breen, and so many others who took a chance on me. And I found a friend in Rich Trumka whose commitment to racial justice was real. It was true. And I'm so grateful for his 25 years of friendship that he put his faith in me and in my good friend, Mark Perrone, to lead the 2015 Race Commission. And then in 2020, he trusted me again to lead our racial justice task force. And Rich would have been proud of the progress that we have made with the task force. And he would have been proud that the delegates of this labor movement that he loves so much just elected a woman and an African American as his top officers. Yeah. You see, this is progress. Dr. King told us that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And I know that's true. I know it's true because I see all of us as a movement working to bend it together, pushing for a better future. It's not easy, and there's no end to it. And it's work we have to do together. All of us moving in the same direction. So where do we go from here? We reach out to meet today's workforce, which has more women and people of color than ever before, and bring them into the fold so that the labor movement that we all love look like our membership at every level. And we keep organizing new workers in new and emerging sectors, athletes, tech workers, workers in the clean energy economy, workers at corporate giants like Amazon, Apple, and Starbucks. And we have to keep fighting until every worker in this country has the chance to have a good union job. A good union job. Everybody in, nobody out. And that means we have to fix our labor laws in order to make that a reality. You see, I know what the labor movement does. I know what it does. It brings the marginalized in from the margins. It brings respect to the disrespected. It lets people come together and collectively bargain for their own future. I know what this labor movement does. This labor movement lets a poor kid from the South Side of Chicago rise up to become the highest ranking African-American officer in the history of the labor movement. I know what this movement can do. I know what it can do. When you gave me your vote today, you gave me your trust. And I will hold on to that trust. I will be accountable to it every single day for you and for every single worker in this country. Let's keep pulling together as a family. Let's keep bending that arc toward justice. Let's win progress for America's workers for today, for tomorrow, and for generations to come. Solidarity, brothers and sisters. And now, it is my high honor and distinct privilege to introduce to you the president of the AFL-CIO, my sister, your sister, our president, our leader, Leah Shuler.
Trying to take it in. The U.S. labor movement is the single most powerful and hopeful movement for progress in this country because of you. And I am grateful to all of you. Thank you for your confidence. Thank you for your trust. And thank you to my family and friends for being here to celebrate this moment. That's right. I'll get to you in a minute. But Fred Redmond, we were a team from day one. We led the AFL-CIO through tragedy after Rich passed unexpectedly. And you are a giant in our movement, and I am honored to be partners with you. Thank you to my biggest supporters, Dave, my husband. We are together in everything, every step of the way. I love you. My friends Kim and Bob, who are here from Oregon, all the way from the West Coast. My neighbors and friends Allison and Mark are here. And I just want to say thank you to the Sunday morning crew. You know who you are, and I appreciate the countless hours that you dedicated over so many months. My dad, Lance, you saw him earlier. I love you, Daddy. And my sister, Anna, thank you for always being the captain to my Tony Tennille. We were children of the 70s. And a wonderful mom to my amazing nephews, Roland and Lance. And it's good to see my brother-in-law, Ansis, here too. I want to thank the staff of the AFL-CIO. And Fred's going to get me in trouble. You named everyone. So I'm just going to say thank you to my staff in the president's office, and I'm so grateful, and really to our entire team at the Federation who's been working so hard on this convention. Unbelievable. Thank you. Thank you for your hard work and solidarity. This has been a year unlike any other. I want to recognize John Sweeney's legacy. And I wish Rich Trumka was here. But we can feel his impact everywhere. And I know Barbara Trumka is here and Rich Jr. is here. I remember talking with Rich about his journey through the labor movement. He always knew that one day he was going to be AFL-CIO president. We talked about it. He worked at it. He built his expertise. He aspired to sit in that leadership chair. I traveled a different path to reach this point, as many women in our movement do. We find ourselves outside the spotlight, doing the hard work behind the scenes, focusing on making big plans come together to benefit the whole. Often we're leaders because we're good organizers. And I learned that from my mom. And from my dad, I learned the value of hard work and a union card. My family's story is an ordinary part of the greater working class story. My dad grew up in a one-room fruit picking shack. He and his four siblings often went hungry. Right after graduating from high school, he enlisted in the Marine Corps and went straight to Vietnam. And when he returned to Oregon, he found a job as a hole digger at Portland General Electric. But it was a power lineman's apprenticeship that put him on a path to a good union job. And that changed everything for our family. In one generation, our family had a roof over our head and enough to eat. That is the power of a union. That is what IBEW 125 meant to my family. But my mom and I also worked at Portland General Electric as clerical workers, and we didn't have a union. That difference showed me that in addition to good pay and benefits, the union also meant dignity, respect, and a voice. And that's how I got my start, by having one-on-one conversations with women who were my coworkers about a fair workplace. And we decided to organize a union. And though we didn't win that drive, it wasn't a failure. Because something always changes for the better. Relationships, possibilities, the way we define the future. And the connections we built at that time helped us defeat a corrupt utility. Later on, many of us remember Enron. No matter the challenge, when we organize, we rise. And I majored in journalism in college because I wanted to shine a spotlight on injustice. But instead of becoming the next Nina Totenberg on NPR, which is what I fantasized about at the time, I fought for justice as an organizer for the IBEW. And as former IBEW President Ed Hill would later explain it, when he hired me, he had this perception of what someone from a power lineman's local was going to look like. And so he took a chance on me, and he would later explain it. He said, oh, she was from a West Coast local that represented power linemen, and I thought they were all men, and I was expecting to see an organizer riding in on a Harley Davidson with hair flapping in the wind. I defied that stereotype. The hair was basically all I had. Didn't have the Harley. But it was emblematic of this notion of opening a door, because Ed Hill gave me an opportunity, and he elevated a sister in the top ranks of the Brotherhood. And as I look at my IBEW family, I just have to thank my president, Lonnie Stevenson, who's been there with me every step of the way. Thank you, Lonnie. Thank you, Kenny. Travis Erie from my home local 125. I know Larry Browning's here. Of course, Rick Deagle, who is not in the room, but who I hope is watching. Sherilyn, I just want to thank everyone in my IBEW family for believing in me. Because I am here because of you and my IBEW siblings. Thank you. I stand on the shoulders of those who came before me, women whose dedicated leadership in our unions, in our workplaces, have moved us all forward. There are too many to mention, and as I'm looking out at all the women in this room, it makes my heart swell. And I just have to say, Arlene Holt Baker, who I know is in the audience, and of course, Linda Chavez Thompson has been mentioned. I know she wasn't able to be here today, but just want to say thank you. My teachers, my leaders. So much more is owed than just saying thank you. Together, we will stand up for equal pay. We will stand up for our autonomy. We will stand up to identify as our true selves at work. He, she, and they. We are going to organize. We are going to organize and rise together to break every glass ceiling, the ones made of glass, but also those made of steel and silicon in those industries of the future. We will elevate women in our movement, center the people who have been excluded, paid the least, but who nevertheless step up the most. Now, my path and style as a leader are different. They reflect the shift that we're seeing in leadership in all walks of life. Less top-down, more inclusive and collaborative. Because it's not about getting credit, it's about results. And results are what the AFL-CIO is organizing to win. Make no mistake, this is a defining moment for our movement. 1 million are dead from COVID. Promises for racial justice have gone unmet. Inequality is resounding. The middle class has been hollowed out. The wealthy concentrated power and profit away from working people. The upward mobility that lifted my family has been reversed. Millennials and Gen Z are backsliding with high rent, low wages, and student debt. And yet, something is happening. We are on the brink of something big. This magic, this power, everyone in the room can feel it. Can you feel it? We are standing up. We are rising. Nurses walked out of hospitals wearing trash bags as makeshift protection against the virus. Then they returned with real PPE and won unions in Maine and North Carolina. 19,000 graduate researchers in California stood up and won a union for a more equitable and inclusive university system. 19,000. Baristas at Starbucks across the country are reclaiming what it means to be a partner. And corporate and retail workers are coming together to organize at Apple. Working people are rising and organizing, and it's having a domino effect. Museum and stadium workers, teachers and students, hotel workers and bus drivers, Capitol Hill staffers, and cannabis workers. We are seeing breakthrough organizing in big tech, like Alphabet and Activision. We are rising so strong that even Microsoft said it will recognize our organizing rights. We're going to hold them to it. Young, Black, Brown, and AAPI workers are leading us and building collective action. That's because the path forward for climate action, racial equity, and the movement for Black lives, disability rights, and pride runs right through the labor movement. Runs right through it. People are turning to unions as a solution to their problems. And thanks to the Biden-Harris administration, the most pro-worker administration in history, we have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. It's not enough to just protect what we have. We're not just going to recover what we've lost. This is about taking risks to define the future on our terms. We are making the jobs of the future union jobs from the start. 80,000 in offshore wind. We are reimagining Appalachia and retiring the Rust Belt label for good. That's right. And everyone should know that after the U.S. military, the labor movement is the largest job training network in the country. We are the bridge. We are the bridge to high growth, high demand careers. As industries change, we are the place where people can upskill and reskill. Our apprenticeship programs have been putting people on the path to the middle class for more than 100 years. That's what lifted my family. And I want every working person in this country, women sidelined from the workforce, people of color written out of worker protections for generations, millions of immigrant workers waiting for their path to citizenship, our formerly incarcerated siblings, the next generation of veterans. Everyone should have the life-changing opportunity of a good union career. Everyone. And as technology changes, we are changing with it. We are working to make sure our tax dollars fund American innovation that benefits us. Everyone included, no community left behind. American-made industries, American-made supply chains, all made with good union jobs. We rise, we organize. And through the power of collective bargaining, we transform. Over generations, workers with the power of collective bargaining won higher wages and better benefits. And we can use collective bargaining to meet our modern needs, like preventing employers from collecting data about us, or ending the toxic work culture that is causing the Great Resignation. And for anyone who needs to hear it, it's okay. I'll say it. You are more than your job. And Elon Musk said the problem is Americans don't want to work. The problem is we are exploited at work. Just look at Amazon, where workers have to leave their dignity behind because democracy is missing from the workplace. Because we know what to do. Democracy rises when we organize. And we are going to amplify the voices of working people, our hopes, our struggles, our demands, one conversation at a time. We will unite around shared values, the dignity of work, a good union job, respect for each other and our diverse communities. This year, in this election coming up, 2022, we are building more than a political program. We are mobilizing for democracy. We will use our voices on the job and at the ballot box. Democracy is a practice, not just an idea. That's right, it's teachers and mine workers and families on strike lines all across the country. It's the strength and resilience of self-determination. Just look at the people in Ukraine. While the richest men on earth might try to divide us or colonize space and treat us like robots, they don't own our humanity, and they don't own our future. A new era for the labor movement starts right here, right now. Now, 10 months ago, I asked our executive council to bring their boldest ideas to this question. What breakthrough do we need? While we supported new collective actions, behind the scenes, outside the spotlight, we strategized, we analyzed, asked and answered, how? Well, we have a visionary way forward. Just as the AFL invested to create the CIO for industrial organizing in the 1930s, today, we are launching the Center for Transformational Organizing, the CTO. This is the vehicle that will accelerate and convert the energy of this moment to take our movement to the next century. The CTO will bring together the brightest organizers, technologists, and researchers. We will develop, implement, and scale powerful campaigns for unprecedented union growth. By concentrating resources and coordinating to achieve the biggest wins, the CTO will use the power of the entire U.S. labor movement. That's 13 million of us in 57 unions in every state, in every zip code, across all industries. And here's the bottom line. In the next 10 years, we will organize and grow our movement by more than 1 million working people. How's that for a goal? And we're going to do it together. All in. One single transformational goal. We rise. We organize. It's what we do. Thank you. Be bold. It's a new story. So this is a story we're going to write together. And this story is going to be on our terms. And it's going to be written by every one of us, and it's going to be a new era for working people all across this country, and I'm so excited. And generations from now, they are going to tell this story of how we succeeded and how we did it together. So let's get started. And I just want to say thank you so much. We have had a very, very long day. And I now get to invite, I believe, Fred up to the stage. Fred, this is our moment. And Fred and I want to say thank you. We will win. We will win.
Organize and rise.
Organize and rise.
Organize and rise. Organize and rise. In our family. And we're going to invite you.
Tomorrow's programming starts at 8:45. We'll hear from Secretary Walsh, and we're kicking things off with a performance by Freestyle Love Supreme. You won't want to miss it. See you in the morning.